Hello and welcome back to Let's Play Cyberpunk 2077 Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Gonna read through some more database entries. I think I am gonna read the vehicles, but I'm probably gonna save that for last. And probably in a later video. Because there's so many. So last episode we read through weapons and world. And then here are tutorial things. So, up to locations now. Afterlife. As the old saying goes, there is only one path in Night City worth walking, the one that leads to the afterlife. Once you make it here, sooner or later, everything else opens up to you. The quest. The afterlife and the world. The afterlife is an iconic bar where the who's who of mercs and first-rate fixers gather to kick back and conduct biz. It's also a major nerve center for the city. This is the place where the biggest deals get cut and the job rewards have the most zeros tacked on. Stop here to spot big names such as Rogue, Dexter Deshawn, and that guy who drank with Morgan Blackhand once. Speaking of, it's said Blackhand's ghost still wanders the bar, switching off the safeties of customers' holstered guns. Haven't seen any evidence of that. Of course, it's probably best to check that out for yourself. That is, provided you've earned enough street cred to get you through the front door. V's Mega Building. Besides the 2,000 apartments identical to V's, this Watson Mega Block also features luxury penthouses on its upper floors. Further down, you can find various service points, stores, market stalls, a gym, even a shooting range. To a certain extent, mega buildings are truly self-sufficient, self-contained ecosystems. Many of their long-term residents, especially netrunners, haven't stepped outside in years. Kanpeki Plaza. Kanpeki Plaza is Night City's most exclusive hotel, an architectural marvel created solely for the elite. This is where global financiers stay for business trips, where nobody bats an eyelid at the sight of two rival corpos having a drink, or a well-known politician going up to their room with a braindance star. Every square inch caters to luxury tastes, and crime comes packed with the most decadent of entertainments, with just a mystery, a hint of mystery, to keep things exciting. Lizzie's Bar. Once a third-rate brothel and sticky dive, today's Lizzie's Bar is today Lizzie's Bar is the bread and butter of the Moxes. A club, the club, oh, what's wrong with me, boasts high-quality brain dances to use in the comfort of specialized booths. You can also see a live show, have a drink, and show off your moves on the dance floor. In 2067, Lizzie's Bar was the scene of a Joy Toy's horrific murder, sparking riots among sex workers, eventually resulting in the gang known as the Mox. Rocky Ridge. It was supposed to measure up to Rancho Coronado. Cozy, practical, self-sufficient, offering a roof over the head for the families of every worker building the nearby highway. Rocky Ridge was sold to people as a paradise guaranteeing peace and quiet, but also just a stone's throw away from the big city and everything it had to offer. Unfortunately, it ended like most investments end in California. The construction became too expensive and Rocky Ridge was no longer economically viable. From one day to the next, the construction sites were deserted, contractors lost their job, and the houses of Rocky Ridge became vacant. Today, the area is mostly abandoned and almost entirely forgotten by Night City, perfect for looters and the occasional band of Raff and Shiv. Old Power Plant. Formerly owned by Electric Corporation, yes, that's a real company, in Charter Hill and abandoned in mysterious circumstances, leaving the surrounding empty buildings unattended. But nothing in cities is truly empty, especially in a metropolis like Night City. The power plant was quickly overrun by gangs that need a lot of space, solid walls, and thick doors to make sure that whatever they're doing doesn't catch the attention of any passersby. Nomad Camps. The life of a nomad is one of constant motion, but although their camps are temporary, they're always designed with function, order, and comfort in mind. Setting up a new camp is a quick operation because everyone knows their responsibilities, working together like parts in a well-oiled machine. As the nomad Santiago once said, "Whenever we make camp, for a short while we become farmers again, and the earlier a farmer finishes his work, the sooner he cracks open a beer." To those who don't buy into the propaganda, nomads are known as hospitable folk. Still, it's better to signal your peaceful attentions from afar, as their camps are well protected. Fourth Wall. An established brain dance studio with years of industry experience, Fourth Wall owns a large recording complex in Japantown. The studio has become famous for its controversial documentaries and reality shows scrolled using the latest brain dance technology. Ebunike? Am I saying that right? The Ebunike is a cargo ship docked in Night City that's been awaiting renovation for the last 30 years. At this point, the scaffolding has more or less become a permanent fixture. The vessel was named after Imboli Ebunike, a former mayor of Night City. Today, the name is associated with the entirety of the docks where it's located that fall under Maelstrom control. For many years, it served as one of Adam Smasher's many hideouts. Clouds. One of the priciest and most technologically advanced dollhouses in Night City, Clouds offers you an experience tailored to your deepest desires you might not even be aware of. First, you jack into the system, then your fantasies and preferences are scanned, and finally the data is automatically transferred to the most suitable doll who eagerly fulfills them. The doll is controlled by a chip, which means they aren't aware of what happens in this session and their memory is wiped every time. That's horrible. Dollhouses are frequented not only by people with your run-of-the-mill fetishes, but also those who are antisocial or cripplingly shy. Oh my god. That's a word. The city and surrounding areas. Encart. Night City Area Rapid Transit. Yeah, cut from the game. Is this Night Corp-owned city public transportation system, which includes both the metro and streetcars. There are currently 6 lines connecting the districts, although expansions to the network have been in the works for years. So this is how you fast travel, but there's supposed to be actual stations you can walk around in, I think. But they're cut from the game. So hopefully a DLC will bring those back. Each Encart station has its own unique atmosphere and, as its passengers note, unique fragrance. I wonder if there's ever a good fragrance. Encart can be dangerous at night and during rush hour, as the gangs, mercs, and regular criminals of the city see the stations and tunnels as natural extension of Night City streets. On the other hand, they say you don't really know the city until you've taken a ride on the Encart. Ho-oh. This Kabuki-based casino is run by the Tiger Claws. The ground floor is the only space accessible to customers, while the rest is occupied by gang operations. If you ever need to get up from a blackjack game to stretch your legs, think twice before heading upstairs. Night City Center for Psychiatric Health. In the age of a rapid increase in cyberpsychosis cases, the psychiatric hospital in Night City seems to offer an earnest solution to one of the city's most burning issues. The clinic boasts a wide range of treatments, from traditional drug therapies and psychotherapy to mind disassemblement and brain dance conditioning. The clinic also prides itself on the innovative Safe Space program, which completely isolates patients, spelled wrong, from the outside world. Some think that getting rid of visiting hours is an essential part of a successful treatment. Others think that these so-called psychiatrists don't want to be caught doing something they shouldn't. Wind Farms. The Wind Farms in the Badlands, property of Night City, once played a major role in the city's power generation before gradually falling into disrepair over the years. Minefield. The minefield out in the Badlands is a legacy of wars long past. The mines were never cleared, meaning the field now serves as natural border protection. The only people who know how to cross it safely are smugglers. Night City. The City of Dreams was founded in the 1990s by visionary industrialist Richard Knight. When the world of late 20th century plunged into chaos, Knight envisioned a modern metropolis free from crime, poverty, and corruption. Right. Corporate partners Arasaka, EBM, and Petrochem, well, I wonder what happened to EBM, helped him realize this vision, investing in the foundation of what would become the Free City of Night City. The city would develop into a haven for young idealists and a beacon for others who sought to fulfill their own dreams. And although Richard Knight fell to assassins, and many new generations seeking fame, fortune, and freedom have suffered their own series of setbacks, the city's legendary status endures today. Night City has it all, from the monumental skyscrapers of industry-leading megacorporations to the luxury villas of world-renowned stars to the lawless neighborhoods where war is waged every day. You will stumble across mercenaries, gangs, and famous rockers, but also junkies, bums, and even cyber psychos. You will stand in the shadows of colossal mega buildings and get lost in the maze of streets, alleys, and markets. You will make your dreams come true, or die trying. Fixers! This is continued into another Fixers entry, so I'm going to skip to the next one after that. Dakota's Place. You'll find Dakota in an auto repair shop in Rocky Ridge. In Night City, that choice of headquarters might seem strange, out in the middle of nowhere. The garage is nothing short of an oasis. This is where Dakota tugs the strands of her intricate webs stretching over the Badlands. If you want to be part of her crew, sooner or later you'll have to pay Rocky Ridge a visit. Regina's Den. If you want to parley with Regina in person, you'll have to head down to Kabuki and Watson. Yalba, the corporate skyscraper where she's located, is hard to miss. It's mostly surrounded by residential buildings, not to mention Lizzie's bar at the Club of the Mox. Regina conducts biz at the top floor, which she has reserved all to herself. Wakako's Den. Wakako has an office in the back room of a pachinko parlor on Jig Jig Street. By day, the parlor is relatively quiet, with biz picking up at night. But Wakako's Den is always an old-school oasis of calm, refined elegance. Yeah, I like Wakako. Muammar El Capitan Reyes's Place. El Capitan has carved out a nice little place for himself by the beltway in Rancho Coronado with a view onto the dam. It's a secluded place, ideal for making deals that require discretion. If there's something you to discuss with Capitan in person, he'll probably want to meet you there. So you'll skip districts and sub-districts for now, and vendor hubs, and go to these fixers. Regina Jones. I guess the other is locations, and these are the fixers themselves. Well, still seems good to follow one with the other. A fixer with... I can almost see her moving. It's funny. A fixer with Chinese heritage operating out of Watson, she used to work as an independent reporter for FTF Radio, but after the station was acquired by the media conglomerate News 54, Regina decided it was time to find a better medium to spread her message. She mobilized all her contacts, from the highest-ranking corpos to the lowliest dealers, gangers, mercs, bums, and junkies. From their point of view, Regina hasn't changed a bit. She's always been a fighter, a girl from the streets. The only difference is that before she sought gossip and sold news, now she spins both. Dino Dinovic. Yo, June. Everyone who's anyone knows him, whether it's Dino the fixer in downtown in Corpo Plaza, or Dino the rocker boy bassist in the notorious band Glory Hole Bandits. What a name. Strangely, despite them playing sold-out shows, nobody's heard Dino play. Really? I guess the bass is drowned out by all the guitars. You holler at Dino when you need something. Pure uncut stimulants, fast loons? Oh, loans. I hate the A's and O's in this. Joy toys for your BFF's birthday party. You might want to start a riot or see somebody's legs broken. Dino's your man. Dino will get it done. Like every good fixer, Dino keeps mixed company. He's just at home with play-hard corpos and top-tier mercs, usually edge runners, as with sketchy media vultures and homeless drifters. You can meet them all in Dino's bar. It's worth dropping in. Someone's bound to pick your brain over a drink or throw up on your shoes. You might leave with a black eye or an STI, but that's how this city rolls? Question mark. Yeah, I haven't visited his place. I've been to Regina's, El Capitan, Wakako, and Dakota. But there's more fixers, too, that... There's a couple more fixers that haven't shown up. That I know I've done some work for. Can't remember the names right now. Muammar El Capitan Reyes. Before he became Santo Domingo's most well-known fixer, El Capitan was Muammar Reyes, a corpo rat at a company that dealt in... Oh, who the hell cares anyway? But all too quickly he realized that with corpse it's always the same old tune. Either they screw you or you screw them. He preferred the latter. Often those who escape poverty like to help out their less fortunate peers, like El Capitan, sort of. On one hand, he makes a fortune as the go-to fixer for half of Santo Domingo's working class, but hey, at least he makes sure people can pay their rent. Don't like it? Find your own gigs. When a gang goon realizes they'd rather save a buck by breaking your legs instead of paying you, look around. Is that Capitan watching from his limo window with a smirk on his face? I don't know. Okaka Okada. If you're looking for decent paying gigs in Westbrook, go to the Pachinko Parlor on Jig Jig Street, run by a fixer named Okako Okada. Rumors abound, but as of yet, nobody's worked up the nerve to ask her about her past and her very many, very dead husbands. She didn't kill any of them, probably, but hey, what's important is that they're gone, and she's still going strong, growing richer and more powerful by the day. Every serious player in Night City respects Okako. Going into a meeting with her is like getting into a cage with a lioness. Sure, the lioness is polite, but you can tell she's already thinking about her next snack. Maybe that's why Wakako's gigs are carried out almost immediately and flawlessly. Wakako takes this entirely for granted. Dakota Smith. The Badlands resident fixer and a member of the Northern Californian Pamo tribe. At first glance, Dakota seems like a harmless desert dweller. It wouldn't be wrong to say that sometime after the Unification War, she lost touch with reality. In her free time, she deciphers the secret language of smoke. But if you ignore that, she's an extremely perceptive fixer with a mind for biz few in this part of California wouldn't envy. Those who take on their jobs always make sure they're done to a T, because firstly, Dakota's never gone behind anyone's back, and secondly, if they decided to go behind hers, they'd be vulture breakfast in no time. You'll also notice she doesn't go anywhere without her oxygen tank. She's been huffing pure oxygen for a few decades now. I'm not sure I ever noticed that on her. Need lots of drinks for this reading. Okay. Districts. The Badlands. If you think Night City is dangerous, just wait till you get to the Badlands. I like driving around the Badlands a lot more. The areas bordering the city to the east and south are actually 8 different zones that vary in character and landscape. There's the trailer park of Red Peaks, the plains of Rocky Ridge, and the desert of Sierra Sonora stretching out to the east, whose landfill emits a stench that's often blown all the way into the city. Saturated with chemicals and acid rain, nothing will ever grow again in this region of the Badlands. Anyone else who has to cross this area does it quickly, and if they're smart, with an armed escort in case they run into wraiths, a gang made up of exiled nomads. You could compare them to vultures, or at least vultures have the decency to wait until their prey is dead. The south points to a much less apocalyptic picture with Biotechnica's protein farms and the Jackson Plains power plant. A trip to the neighboring lake of Laguna Bend at sunset is the most picturesque view the Badlands has to offer. Just make sure you don't touch the water. There's a saying that everyone should visit the Badlands at least once in their lives. Sounds like something the Wraiths would say. City Center. If you stand in the middle of Corpo Plaza and observe what's around you, all the breathtaking mega buildings, office blocks, bars, clubs, architectural wonders, and dazzling neon signs, it's hard to believe that only a few decades ago the area looked like a smoldering battlefield in the aftermath of the Fourth Corporate War and the nuclear attack on Arasaka Tower. As anyone with a pair of optics can see, City Center was fully rebuilt, surpassing even its former glory with more modern and cutting-edge architecture. It serves one purpose, and one purpose only, to flaunt the city's economic power and prove that Night City is freer than ever before. Haywood. Haywood is a district of contradictions. The northern part that borders the city center is modern and well-kept, proud of its stunning mega-buildings, parks, and places that are open to the public, but all you have to do is go a few blocks southeast and the scenery starts to change dramatically. This part of Haywood is much poorer and even more dangerous. The buildings are smaller and the streets are controlled by the Valentinos and the 6th Street Gang. If you know your place and keep your head down, Haywood isn't really so bad. After all, it's where most of Night City sleeps. If you're not a corpo and you score an apartment in the richer part of the district, then you've just won the lottery. Otherwise, just be happy you live in Haywood. In Night City, things could always be worse. Pacifica. You could say that Pacifica is almost a microcosm of Night City's history. It started with, "We're building a paradise," and ended with, "Dear God, what a nightmare." On paper, it was meant to be the classiest and most iconic district catering to corporate employees. Night City's take on Las Vegas in its heyday. Luxury hotels, entertainment halls, sandy beaches. Sadly, that Pacifica only existed in the blueprints drawn up by architects for fat cat investors. Those same investors pulled out every last penny after the Unification War broke out, fearing yet another intercorporate conflict. Pacifica was abandoned by all but the local Haitian community, led by a gang of netrunners called the Voodoo Boys. You don't have anything written for their entry. The city has repeatedly tried and failed to bring the district back into the fold, but it remains isolated with its own rules, language, manufactured goods, illegal in Night City, and independent net. You could say that Pacifica has blossomed under the Voodoo Boys' leadership, but Poison Oak would be a more suitable metaphor. To anyone who enters, beware. Santo Domingo. Santo Domingo is one of Night City's oldest districts. Luckily, its location meant it avoided the worst damage from the Fourth Corporate War, although the tens of thousands of Night citizens deprived of their homes still built provisional camps and settlements. Today, no trace of them remains. Santo Domingo has instead become an industrial hub with an abundance of enterprises and manufacturing and power plants. Corporations are in constant battle over influence in the district. Real estate changes hand, new businesses pop up, and old businesses fall. Meanwhile, construction sites are guarded by combat troops guarding corporate property and secrets, though they often serve as law enforcement in cases when a company shuts down and fires all its staff, mostly around Rancho Coronado, raising the risk of riots. Westbrook. A fair amount of Night City's citizens firmly believe that Westbrook is the best district to live in. After all, that's where the richest and most influential people of Night City live, including the picturesquely situated North Oak, probably the most beautiful neighborhood in the city. Charter Hill has its charm, too, home to ambitious and enterprising corpos who are about halfway up their career ladder. Last but not least, Japantown is widely known as Night City's party district. Yes, indeed, Westbrook is where everyone wants to be, but it wasn't always like that. Over 50 years ago, after the nuclear attack on Arasaka in 2023, the part of Westbrook next to Night City suffered serious damage. The bomb's earthquake completely wiped out Japantown's high-rises, leaving behind ghostly, crooked skeletons looming over the district for the next two decades. Charter Hill was inundated with refugees. Even North Oak saw ramshackle huts and tents hastily put up on its slopes. Luckily, by the 40s, the great restoration of Night City was already underway. The ruins of mega buildings were removed, replaced by shiny monoliths from predominantly Asian corporations, returning Japantown to its former glory. Charter Hill was also cleaned up and soon saw new homes for corpo employees. The refugee and homeless encampments in North Oak lasted for much longer, remaining a sore sight for the city's authorities. Crime levels there beat the city's records, for a time even soaring above those of the combat zone. Eventually, the area was brought to order with the help of mercenaries, and shortly after it became the North Oak we know today, the most exclusive and secure area of Night City. Watson. Watson was supposed to be the beating heart of Night City. A few decades ago, Japanese zaibatsus invested billions of euro dollars in skyscrapers, nightclubs, the med center, even industry in the northern area, all intended to make the district self-sufficient and prosperous. But everything changed when Arasaka returned to the city after the Unification War. The corporation steamrolled all of its competitors, and without a stable financial sector, Watson caved in on itself. Jobs in the North Side Industrial District completely evaporated, leaving people out on the street, allowing Arasaka to buy up the now cheap real estate. Turns out the move was calculated. Arasaka needed port access. Today, Watson is one of Night City's poorest districts, inhabited mainly by workers in Northside earning ennies. Subdistricts. Arroyo. When are they going to finish Arroyo? Residents like to joke about their district. For many, it seems like a never-ending construction site, with buildings being bulldozed overnight to make way for new ones the same morning. Arroyo currently hosts a power plant, a fully automated factory, a logistics center, and a gigantic landfill. Arroyo's no Pacifica, but investment has been shaky. Driving through, you'll see scores of decrepit or unfinished buildings, but just because the factories and warehouses are closed doesn't mean they're abandoned. Many of them served as hideouts for the Sixth Street Gang. Perhaps then it isn't strange that whatever's still owned by Arasaka or Petrochem is carefully guarded by corporate military squads. Charter Hill. Charter Hill is known as a comfortable and relatively safe neighborhood for those who can afford it. It was rebuilt in the 40s during the Reconstruction. The new and swanky Charter Hill quickly became a go-to for Night City's elites. at least until North Oak overtook it as the most luxurious neighborhood. Most of Charter Hill's homes are occupied by middle-ranking corpos who bang their heads against their desks by day and get sloshed in bars by night. The other residents are made up of aspiring artists, entrepreneurs, and any freelancer who makes enough to avoid renting a closet room in Little China or Wellsprings. Coast View. The northern part of Pacifica, bordering West Wind Estate and the inaccessible Combat Zone. The Voodoo Boys are most powerful in this district, particularly in the area of the Market, Batty's Hotel, and Pacific Serenity Bible Church. The gangs hold weakens once they reach the Grand Imperial Mall, homeless encampments, and the old Ferris wheel, where the scavengers reign supreme. You've been there? If you're wondering which part of Coastview is safest, go back to the beginning and read the whole thing again. This isn't a guidebook. There's no stars or reviews. Just consider yourself warned. Corpo Plaza. Rebuilt after the Fourth Corporate War, Corpo Plaza is one of the most iconic places in Night City today as a symbol of corporate prowess. Its Goliath skyscrapers and mega buildings are an economic show of force and prestige for corporations such as Arasaka and Militech, as well as proof of their inferiority complex. Right. Corpo Plaza's main attraction is Memorial Park, a huge ring surrounding the corporate headquarters. That's where we are now, in the station. The park is also a tribute to the countless victims of the Fourth Corporate War. Every day, the plaza is teeming with everyone from corpo suits to NCPD officers and armed-to-the-teeth corpo security. More than anything, an indication that peace and order are not among Night City's natural qualities. Downtown. Downtown is one of the newest districts in Night City, having been rebuilt after the Arasaka headquarters bombing. If you buy a postcard in Night City, chances are it has a picture of downtown, with its sky-high office and apartment buildings, corporate hotels, and exclusive restaurants. It all screams glamour and luxury. No matter where you'll turn, you see animated billboards and ads for bars, BD clubs, or love hotels. For those who have cash to spend, downtown is the beating heart of the city. But like all other districts, downtown also has a darker side. After dusk, it's in sketchy alleyways, hotels, and bars. You can meet dealers offering synthetic drugs and illegal brain dances. Most places offering nighttime entertainment are also guarded by gang members. Businessmen and criminals, prestige and fraud, power and brute strength, these are all two sides of the same coin called downtown. The Glen. Rewind a few decades back, and Night City Council was on its knees begging corporations to help rebuild the city. The Glen became home to the new City Hall. It's no surprise then that the Glen feels much safer and organized than other districts, with millions of eddies invested on every corner. Reconciliation Park promises a literal breath of fresh air, while the elegance of the surrounding architecture reminds you that the bustle of Night City is never out of reach. City Hall is the main attraction of the Glen and the seat of the city's mayor. But venture away from the tidiness and sophistication, and you quickly start noticing run-down buildings and the menacing faces of the Valentinos and the Sixth Street Gang. You won't get that in tourist guides. Still, the very fact that there's a drastic social and economic difference only a few blocks away from the City Hall says a lot about how the city is run. Japantown. Given its popularity with tourists, it's no wonder Japantown feels like it's constantly buzzing with life. Crowds occupy the local bars, upscale restaurants, arcades, the famous Cherry Blossom Market, and especially the Shinto Shrine that's a must-see if you're in the area. Every corner holds a luxurious backdrop for a perfect photo op. Japantown doesn't disappoint. So what's the catch, you might ask? Japantown can be expensive, especially its nighttime attractions. Corpos with fat cred ships come here to play hard after a few hard day's work, with cash liquid tourists right beside them. Local brain dance clubs, casinos, and bars are never short on customers. Just watch out for the tiger claws. They rule Japantown. Kabuki. Once upon a time, Kabuki touted an impressive cluster of corporate medical office buildings located right next to the famous Med Center. Kabuki prided itself for a reputation of being a tidy, elegant district. That is, until Arasaka swallowed up every last competitor. Ever since then, Kabuki, not counting Pacifica, is known as the poorest district of Night City. But Kabuki is far from empty. An influx of Chinese immigrants have turned Kabuki's winding streets into a lively bazaar where one can find almost anything for a fraction of the market rate. At night, the Chinese lanterns and flickering neons light up the stalls of Night City's biggest black market for implants, organs, drugs, stolen prototypes, steroids, viruses, and malware, XBDs, you name it, Kabuki will have it. The district is heavily crowded, save for its northern stretches, where abandoned warehouses and disused factories have become occupied by gangers and outcasts of all stripes and colors. Kabuki is largely controlled by the Tiger Claws. Occasionally, you might also spot Maelstrom. Some local gangs thrive, such as the Mox, who run the most popular brain dance club in the city, Lizzie's Bar. Alright, so I just got these then. Little China. In the 40s, this part of Watson aspired to be the next city center. Corps invested heavily in the area, putting up towers and cutting-edge clinics such as the Med Center. That's where you slap down your cred chip for implants, that is, if you wanted to get them legally. But soon enough, this neighborhood became populated with immigrants, mostly from China, hence the name. Over the next few decades, the district became increasingly more populated and diverged from its original plans. Today, Little China is considered a poor district, but its food, smells, neon lights, tucked away little shops, and overall atmosphere draws the crowds. Even low-ranking corpos drop in to gamble and put euro-dollar bills into thongs. The sight of suits strolling past the homeless also shouldn't take anyone here by surprise. Need another drink? Northside Industrial District, NID. The Northside Industrial District, NID, was once an important area of Watson with factories employing thousands of night citizens. Today it feels neglected and devoid of life. Most of the factories shut down, parts of buildings were damaged by earthquakes, and property developments left unfinished. The center of the NID is divided by a row of towering apartment buildings, purposely constructed to shield the wealthy from a pretty depressing view. They're occupied by mid-ranking workers that are still employed by the last remaining industries operating in the NID. With few prospects to cling to, these workers' only hope is that they don't close down, because outside of the NID, there's no future for them. As they say, you move to Northside, you'll die in Northside. Often that's just interpreted to mean you'll catch a stray bullet from one of the ubiquitous maelstromers. Rancho Coronado. Some insist that Rancho Coronado is not a district of Night City, but in fact a little town situated at its edge. It could seem that way at first sight, with its identical townhouses reminiscent of the classic 20th century inner city suburb, quaint stores, bars, a park, school, and subway station. Sounds like the American dream, right? Well, that's exactly what the land and factory owners of Arroyo thought when they designed the neighborhood. Every building was intended for workers living near their respective plants. Corporations even made sure that Rancho Coronado had its own law enforcement, since the NCBD couldn't be relied on. Rancho Coronado now mostly houses middle and higher-ranking corporate employees from nearby factories and offices who wanted to get away from the city. Residents from other districts like to joke that it resembles more of a hamster cage. Everyone in Rancho Coronado has everything they need in one place. You've got your wheel, your water, your food. What more could you ask for? Vista Del Rey. There's no need to sugarcoat it. Vista Del Rey is the worst part of Haywood, eaten alive by poverty and oppression. Gangs are the neighborhood's undisputed rulers, though the streets they rule over are often deserted. Fugitives or suspicious types hide in the shadows of mega buildings that have seen much better days. Now their run-down exteriors seem to scorn you as you pass them. It's no wonder then that Vista is a thorn in the side of the powers that be in neighboring districts like Corpo Plaza and North Oak. Corporate executives would happily forget about the squalor of Haywood if it weren't literally right on their doorstep. Every once in a while, rumors circulate that the city's authorities could take over and clean up Vista Del Rey, but who will actually step up to the task? Wellsprings. They say Wellsprings is where you can find the average middle-class night citizen. They're not entirely wrong. Situated next to city center, the buildings are modern-looking, reminiscent of the city's overhaul after the Fourth Corporate War. But the further southeast you go, the more the architecture becomes more diminished, older and often neglected, homes that aren't expensive here. You can even score a 400-something square foot apartment for a decent price. In other words, Well Springs is pretty stable until you find yourself in the eastern part of the district, where the houses look like they're about to fall apart, and distrusting faces leer at you from broken windows. Valentino's graffiti covers the walls, but as long as you don't get in their way, they couldn't give less of a crap about you. On the other hand, the scavengers of the south, well, let's just say that you've got any ounce of sense in your skull, you won't find yourself there after dark. West Wind Estate. The southernmost part of Pacifica, West Wind Estate is also the district's most neglected region. Cut off from the rest of the city by the combat zone and Coast View, the area is weakly held by the Voodoo Boys. You can find them by Las Palapas Motel, while scavengers are a common sight. Arasaka Waterfront. When it comes to the waterfront, it's pretty simple. Either you're from Arasaka, or you should leave the area. The mega corporation has made the waterfront its logistical hub. According to official figures, every month hundreds of shipments are inspected and stored in automated warehouses, then shipped all over the country. What's in those shipments and what really goes on at the waterfront is unknown. The Arasaka waterfront is surrounded by a reinforced wall equipped with extra security measures. Officially, it's there to protect Arasaka's interest against gangs, scavengers, nosy reporters, and the ordinary citizens of Watson who might accidentally get lost. But is that the real reason? Vendor Hubs. Cargo Bay. A shady scavenger-run marketplace in Northside. The vendors set up their wares in old repurposed transport containers, and most of what they offer has been smuggled in. Kabuki Roundabout. Despite its name, it's not a place where cops go in circles, where cars go in circles, rather, but a Chinese-inspired architectural gem that pays tribute to Kabuki's uniqueness. This is where old friends pick up where they left off over a bowl of ramen, and kids gawk at the nearest braindance ads. This is where the second shift meets the third on its way to the NID, while black market trade goes on long into the early hours. Almost every corner of Kabuki Roundabout is occupied by street stalls with high-end brands sold at low, low prices. Ermland Street. A little shopping street in Little China, Ermland is a bright, noisy marketplace of all your heart's desires. There you can get preem clothing, flashy cyberware, heavy weapons, the latest horrible venereal diseases. All depends what you're looking for. The Badlands Dam. A multi-million euro-dollar undertaking, an industrial feat, 2 million hectoliters of toxic water and hundreds of flooded homes. Welcome to the Badlands. When the dam was under construction, it was obvious there would also be a reservoir, which sounded great in theory. The townsfolk put that piece of knowledge in the back of their heads and didn't stop to wonder why they needed a dam. Why here, of all places? And who was profiting from it? Spoiler alert, it wasn't the town's residents. And since losers don't get to write history, any memory of them and their tragedy evaporated from the collective consciousness as quickly as the morning dew on a hot summer's morning. Now, I could stop here, but we had a long... I think I'll just finish it, believe it or not. Quite a few. Story character, or other characters and story characters. And I'll read about cars another time. There's quite a few of those. And I really don't feel like reading about cars, so. Other characters. Jotaro Shobo. If Night City had a contest for the most rotten to the core piece of human garbage, Jotaro Shobo would stand a pretty decent chance of winning. Maybe not first place, but he'd definitely be up there. Jotaro is a high-ranking Tiger Claw's ganger, who, thanks to his intelligence, loyalty, and ruthlessness, quickly made his way up the pecking order. He rules his lackeys with an iron fist and is never late with his cut for the bosses, who repay him with protection and turning a blind eye to his various hobbies. One of them includes recording brain dances, and anyone who's relived them calls him the Devil of Kabuki. Mikhail Akulov. Officially, the Soviet fixer is on a diplomatic business trip in Night City, but most take that explanation with a heap of salt. Unfortunately, one rumor has it that Akolov has been seduced by Night City's capitalist libertine charms. Still, the million-euro-dollar question remains, what is he really doing here? Many would pay handsomely for the answer. After all, this is a man who represents the interests of the entire USSR. Gottfried Persson. Kind of looks like John Lithgow there. Gottfried's work is the stuff of another person's nightmares. Nightmares often come true in Night City, and when they do, he takes them, or buys them, and edits them to turn a profit. As a matter of fact, he's fairly well respected in the obscure circle of illegal brain dance editors. He's a craftsman without a conscience, an advantage in his line of work. If the material is good, Gottfried will take a raw BD from anyone and fine-tune the emotions, no questions asked. The closest person to him is his son, Frederick, whom he taught and trained in his craft. When they're not editing together, they manage a deep net sight. Frederick, speaking of who? Frederick Persson. Throughout their lives, many a man has struggled to break free from their father's shadow, but not Frederick. The shadows suit him just fine. He has everything he needs, money and emotional fulfillment. Gottfried is professional and knowledgeable, while Frederick is passionate and uncompromising. Together they form a duo that Night City happens to need. After all, someone has to edit all those illegal brain dances. Iris Tanner. Iris Tanner is a talented techie and a textbook example of someone whose job is their life. When it comes to a gig, it's never about the money, but the challenge. Still, that doesn't stop her from being a tough negotiator. It's the only way to be taken seriously. Despite being terse and hard to talk to, she's convinced she's good at reading people. What she doesn't realize is that her deep-seated desire to be admired for her skills actually makes her easy to manipulate. That's one of the reasons she got into serious trouble with the Raffin Shiv. On principle, Iris doesn't work with fixers, but she's willing to make an exception for Dakota, not because she likes her, but because this time she needs her. Gustavo Orta. Bring me the head of a Gustavo Orta, right? Yeah, I killed him. Open an encyclopedia and flip to the Valentinos, you should find a picture of Gustavo Orta, or most likely his mugshot. But who reads encyclopedias these days anyway? Just one look at Gustavo Orta and you know he's a Valentino inside and out. His style could be characterized as ruthless, a trait that certainly helped him climb to the peak of the gang's ranks. Recently, however, Gustavo has been acting strangely. If the rumors are true, he spends more time silently contemplating the water in the bay than doing what he's been known and feared for, brutally stamping out his rivals in Haywood. Corporal Hare. When 17-year-old William Hare first saw a poster promoting service in military's paramilitary forces, he finally understood his purpose in life. As his impressionable eyes scanned the multi-million-dollar equipment and armored soldiers, he felt a brutal power and desire for adventure swell inside him. How could a kid who spent his whole life in the slums of Rancho Coronado resist? The promotional specialists in Militech's recruitment office certainly think so, and they're usually right. Hare enlisted and eventually rose to the rank of corporal. He got everything he dreamed of, plus more. Combat, military-grade cyberware, a sense of power, camaraderie, and adventure. As for the latter, there are some parts he'd rather forget, especially the ones he's forgotten to talk about. After Brazil, everything changed. He lost his good health and came back to Night City a veteran, but with no hope of ever returning to active duty. That's when Hare first asked himself, had Militech taken away more than they gave him? Flavio dos Santos. Some people are luckier than they deserve to be. No matter what they do, they always land on all fours without a scratch. Sooner or later, they start thinking they're invincible, and that's when they become dangerous, to themselves and everyone around them. Nobody fits that description better than Flavio. Chatty and grinning a Cheshire grin, he thinks he can do whatever he wants. Better to steer clear of people like him, unless, of course, someone pays you to help him out. And story characters, Jackie Wells. I miss Jackie. A proud son of Haywood and an even prouder son of Mama Wells, Jackie's stubborn. When he wants something, he won't stop or shut up about it until he gets his hands on it. Jackie always wanted a lot out of life, maybe too much. As a teenager, he joined the Valentinos gang, but realizing how much he was capable of, he quit. For years, he hustled through the unforgiving world of merc work. Because you need more than a go-getter attitude to sit at the big boy's table. You need street cred. Jackie's life goal is always to become a legend at the afterlife and make a heap of eddies along the way. Here's my buddy, Victor Vector. If you want decent chrome, you go to Vix. While other places might seem like spaceship interiors crossed with Zen rooms, his Ripper Dot Clinic is no nonsense and doesn't bombard customers with corporate logos. If you're nice, he might even give you a beer with your anesthesia before he starts cutting. If you're nice. That's what I said. Victor Vector is actually one of the living legends of Night City, a fact he's been trying to get people to forget for years. He's a man of principle, an old-school tough guy from the streets for whom honor and morals were forged in the Night City Devil's Boxing Club. Misty. While Victor is a healer of bullet and blade wounds, Misty is a mender of broken spirits. Misty's Esoterica, a small shop in front of a Ripper Dot clinic, is stocked with an assortment of aura-cleansing incense sticks, yarrow stems, Tibetan Book of the Dead shards, and pendants for good luck. Though Misty gets more customers than Vector, this smart and sensitive woman somehow always finds the time to help her friend in difficult moments, at times almost taking on the role of a full-fledged nurse. Dexter DeShawn. Dex never shot hoops, jump roofs, or pull the trigger. Likewise, he never felt the need to plant his fat butt in a netrunner's chair or splice cables in a sooty garage. Wait, never pull the trigger? Yes, that's right. Dex never popped lead in his entire life. That's what Dex was good at. Or people, that's what Dex was good at. Dex is one of the biggest fixers in Night City. He's a pretty big deal, both literally and figuratively. Word on the street is that there were complications from his last job. But that's just the nature of biz, ain't it? Besides, when someone like Dexter DeShawn is a geek for you, you don't ask questions, you just shake on it. Judy Alvarez. Sweetie. One of Braindance's most gifted editors and a skilled techie. If she wanted to, she could get hired at any corpo entertainment studio and make bank. But Judy values her independence too much to sell out. She rejects every offer that comes her way. Her anarchist spirit drew her to the Mox in the hope that they could improve the lives of people in Night City. Her biggest flaw is that she can't keep her mouth shut in the face of injustice, something that always gets her in trouble. For some, though, it's her greatest virtue. Yorinobu Arasaka. The son of Saburo Arasaka, leader of the world's biggest arms manufacturing corporation. Ever since his young, rebellious years, there's been a lot of friction between Yorinobu and his father, though as to why, that's anyone's guess. Known for his difficult personality and controversial opinions, he doesn't fulfill any important role in Arasaka. Despite his urgent calls for change in the corporation, Yorinobu doesn't really want to take the helm. Being a billionaire is currently much more fun. And then his father, Saburo Arasaka. CEO of the Arasaka Corporation. After elevating his father's Japanese company out of relative obscurity to become a global powerhouse, Saburo is now widely regarded as the founder of the Arasaka Empire. This former Japanese Imperial Navy pilot transformed into the ruthless businessman who now stands at the helm, well, not anymore, of the world's largest arm manufacturer. He is a man who, for decades, has been rumored to be able to force even the most cold-blooded assassins to commit suicide at his command, which may say as much about his virtually absolute rule as it does his extraordinarily prolonged lifespan. Delamine. If you ever wish to leave your problems at the door, make sure it's at the door of a Delamine luxury cab. Delamine is the only cab service in Night City manufactured by an artificial intelligence and prioritizes passenger safety as highly as comfort. Delamine's intriguing personality alone is a reason enough to travel in his company. He is likewise an excellent business partner due to his boundless dedication to improve the quality of his services through effective management and innovative technologies. Sponsored by Delamain Corp. Adam Smasher. Wow. With a full body conversion, not much is left of Adam Smasher the man. Well, his humanity was always questionable. Smasher is in charge of taking out Arasaka's dirty laundry, but he likes to do things his own way. Way back in 2023, he killed Johnny Silverhand during the attack on Arasaka Tower, after which Silverhand's personality was digitized by the Soul Killer program. If Smasher finds out that Johnny's back, he'll probably want to finish what he started. Smasher doesn't leave loose ends. Johnny Silverhand. This looks like it could continue, but I guess it doesn't, because I can't scroll it. They say you can become a legendary rocker boy without all the sex and drugs, the manic depression, run-ins with the law, and one toxic relationship after another. But Johnny Silverhand's old school. Can or can't? Makes more sense, but can't here. Front man for samurai, charismatic visionary, rebel with a cause, sworn enemy of corporations, but especially Arasaka, and the mind behind the cult singles Chippin' In and Never Fade Away, currently residing in V's brain as a digitized tenant. Silverhand met his demise during the attack on Arasaka Tower after getting shot by Adam Smasher and subsequently flatlined by Soul Killer. But some rocker boys never really die. Point in case, Silverhand's personality construct was kept in Arasaka's labs for decades before it landed on a prototype biochip called the Relic, which, following a series of unexpected events, ended up in V's brain. If you think spending eternity in a cyberspace prison is worse than sharing your headspace with a complete stranger, you'd be dead wrong. For an egomaniac and narcissist like Johnny, it's a living hell. So he is a narcissist. Goro Takamura. The only bodyguard of Saburo Arasaka who truly done screwed up. While obeying orders, he was unable to prevent the death of his master at the hands of Saburo's son, Yorinobu. After the relic was stolen, Takamura went after the thieves, eventually leading him to a landfill, where he zeroed Dexter Deshawn and saved V, the sole living witness to Yorinobu's crime. In his mission to find the truth, Takamura became Arasaka's most wanted fugitive, pursued by every agent in the Night City. The ex-bodyguard is driven by a desire for vengeance and won't rest until he brings Saburo's murderer to justice, even if it means working with a petty thief like V. Hey, you're going to petty thief. V. Corpo. Few leave the corporate world with their lives, fewer still with their souls intact. You've been there, you've bent the rules, exploited secrets and weaponized information. There's no such thing as a fair game, only winners and losers. So obviously if you played the game with the other two origins, you'd have, you wouldn't have V. Corpo, you'd have your origin. You have something about your origin written there. Panam Palmer. Panam is a nomad, although maybe ex-nomad rings truer these days. She locked horns with the family's leader, Saul, left Aldecaldo Nation, and moved to Night City to try her luck as a merc. Panam's life is at a crossroads. On one hand, she knows her life needs a change. It's now or never. On the other hand, burning bridges with the nomad family where all her friends were might have been a bit drastic. On top of that, Night City doesn't take too kindly to nomads or have patience for people like Panam, who are internally conflicted and dream of a brighter future. Anders Hellman. Anders Hellman is Arasaka's leading bioengineer, an expert in neural networks with a number of groundbreaking patents under his belt and one of the megacorporation's pillars as director of the Relic Project. Using Soul Killer's source code, Hellman created a piece of tech capable of communicating with personality constructs. He has a pretty high opinion of himself. He believes he's irreplaceable and too valuable for Arasaka to simply ever let him go. I don't know. Saul Bright, head of the Aldecaldo family that also counts Panam among its members. After becoming a leader, he broke away from the clan's tradition of smuggling and tried to establish corporate connections, which didn't exactly go down well at the back of the camp. The truth is, Saul became a leader at a very difficult time when any strategic slip could tear the entire family apart. He's always tried to do the right thing and never denied responsibility for his own choices. Uncompromising, stubborn, bold, and principled, he commands a kind of reluctant respect that's usually reserved for the most righteous and thus unbearable. Hanako Arasaka. Oh, that's what she looks like. Daughter of Saburo Arasaka and one of the most enigmatic figures in the Arasaka Corporation. Her past is shrouded in secrecy and closely guarded by a team of lawyers prepared to torpedo any journalistic inquiry into her life. The predominant theory about her early life suggested that she was forbidden from leaving the family's residence near Tokyo until she came of age. Only her skills as a netrunner, that's cool, kept Hanako from becoming completely cut off from the outside world. Many also believe that she helped her brother, Yorinobu, return to the family after his infamous rebellion came to a fruitless halt. Although Hanako has never held any official position within the company, the buzz around her involvement in behind-the-scenes corporate scheming continues to grow. That said, separating truth from speculation remains nearly impossible. Rumors about Hanako Arasaka never last long, and neither do the people who spread them. T-Bug. Yeah, I miss T-Bug, too. T-Bug is a textbook example of how solos and netrunners really aren't all that different. Both take on risky contracts that usually end in dust-ups with corporations or the law, ever walking the tightrope between life and death. After all, black ice isn't any less dangerous than taking a bullet. T-Bug's well aware of this fact, and as a legit specialist in her field, she's fully within her rights to be picky about her contracts. Unlike more reckless netrunners, T-Bug intends to sail into retirement age, preferably with enough eddies to leave this goddamn city behind her for good. Royce isn't the kind of guy you forget, and not just because his fashion sense includes a set of red-hot LED optics straight from hell. No, what stays burned in your memory is his manic, obsessive, erratic, paranoid, trifet, tweaked behavior. As a leader, he's always been polarizing. Either his goons love him, or they hate him. But if Royce truly is mad, he might just be the most brilliant, methodical madman in the city. He's been running Maelstrom's affairs with surprising success, probably because the only way to stay alive is to do biz with him. Lucius Rhine. Oh yeah, mayor of Night City, considered by many to be the right man for his time and place, and by others as the city's biggest crook. During the Unification War, when NUSA forces tried to take the city and annex it into the Union, Rhine led the city's valiant defense. Under his leadership, Militech's tanks were repelled, and the Night City became fully independent. Despite continuous accusations that Rhine is greasing his palms with corporate money, for many he remains a symbol of Night City's freedom. Mitch Anderson. Mitch is a member of the Bright family, a group of nomads in the Aldecaldos nation. During the Unification... I'm surprised they actually have an entry for Mitch. Okay. During the Unification War, along with a number of other Aldecaldos, Mitch fought on the side of the Free States with the Panzer Boys, a division of elite combat AVs and armored vehicles. After coming back from the front, Mitch helped the Aldecaldos with their smuggling operation, a much better fit for him than fighting on the battlefield. He's good friends with Panam and is one of the most respected members of the family, loyal to his friends, uncompromising with everyone else. Finn Gristat. Oh, I hate this guy. Jig Street's best Ripper Doc, Fingers, as he calls himself, thinks very highly of himself. Truth is, he's just not the worst. What he lacks in equipment, he makes up for with determination and resourcefulness, which is why some also call him the Recycle Doc. His services are sought after not only by the sex workers off Jig Street, but the whole city. Fingers can fix just about anything, and they'll always start a tab when you're flat broke. True, his quirkiness, obsession with the human body, or his clammy hands could put some people off, but then again, he's the best Jig Street's got. Which isn't saying much. Oswald Woodman Forrest. Cloud's our very own caretaker. Woodman, as he's called. Yeah, I killed him too. Is responsible for evaluating the doll's performance and the guy who solves problems. He didn't look like that. He didn't look like that to me. Including disposing of problematic dolls. A smooth operator with ties to the tiger claws, he's right where he wants to be. Ridiculously self-assured, generally rude, and a smartass, some say Woodman was born without an ounce of empathy, but that's not entirely true. He has felt compassion, once, but didn't see any use for it. Still, people like Forrest are indispensable to greasing the mighty cogs of the porn industry machine. Oda. Hanako Arasaka's bodyguard, she looks cool, who also happens to be a cyber ninja trained by Takamura. Oh, I thought it was a she. He was supposed to be the key to solving V and Takamura's problems, but only ended up as one more threat among many. During their secret meeting at the docks, he declined their plea for help and gave them one last chance to leave the city. Yeah, I remember that. He's never further than a step away from Hanako, so it'll be difficult to reach her. That'll be interesting. Joshua Stevenson. In prison for armed robbery and first-degree murder, Joshua Stevenson has had his 5 seconds of fame upon converting to Christianity. After a series of late-night show appearances and televised debates, some still doubt whether Stevenson's conversion was genuine. Mama Wells. Guadalupe Alejandra Wells. But everyone calls her Mama. It's almost taken for granted that whoever walks through her front door can count on being listened to as well as sitting down for a delicious meal. And like every mother, she would give up anything, even her life, to protect her children. Sad for her. An important figure in Haywood, even the toughest Valentinos had not an respect when she passes. Padre even once said that not only does Mama Wells have a good heart, but she's tougher than any ganger in the district. Claire Russell. Oh, she looks so pretty there. Every regular at the Afterlife knows Claire, the bartender who knows every favorite drink, who knows their favorite drink by heart, what they drank last time, and even what their friends ordered. Likewise, most know a few facts about Claire, too. She's a trans woman. Did we know that? Who hasn't installed a single piece of cyberware in her body. She quit her job as a Militech engineer, and she's responsible for immortalizing Night City legends by naming drinks after them on the bar menu. Posthumously, of course. What not all Afterlife clients know, however, is that Claire owns her own auto shop where she can be found spending hours under the hands of broken-down cars, and Beast, the rig she takes out on less-than-legal street races. And finally, Rogue. I'm upset we don't have a an entry for Bugbear. I guess there's not much to say about her. Rogue. In her younger days, she was a professional merc. Today, she's the queen of fixers, one of the last legends of Night City who's more than just handed down stories. Unlike her friends from the good old days, read Johnny Silverhand, Rogue does more than get by. She runs the Afterlife and, by definition, almost the entire Night City merc network. Every serious job needs her thumbs up, and V's mission to find Anders Hellman is very serious indeed. Cool. Alright, so we've read everything except for cars. Or vehicles, rather. There's a few of those. So, next episode, we'll be back to the action. Actually doing side jobs and assaults in progress and stuff like that. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.